We discussed the motivation behind data loaders, but let's now get to the practical part and implement efficient data loaders. So in this part, we will be inspecting and setting up the dataset. So we will start by obtaining the dataset. In this particular case, we will obtain this dataset from GitHub, from a repository that I prepared for simplicity. And so to clone a GitHub repository in a Jupyter session or Python session, we are going to use this Git Python library, which you may have to install if you have not installed it yet. For reference, the exact version numbers I used are listed here. So let's clone a repository that I previously prepared. It's just containing the MNIST images as PNG files. And this one will create this MNIST PNGs folder on your computer. So this might take a while, but then you should have the MNIST PNG files on your computer. So after this code finished executing, you should have this MNIST PNGs folder on your computer. So if you go in there, you should have a test and a train partition where each of these folders contains 10 subfolders, each subfolder corresponding to the different class labels. So class label 0, class label 1, and so forth. And each of these subfolders should have thousands of images. So in addition to that, there should also be a train and a test CSV file, which we are going to load now in our Jupyter session. So let's load the CSV file here. For that, we are going to use pandas as usual. So we are importing pandas, use the readCSV function, and take a peek at the training dataset. So what we can see here is, these are the first five lines. What we can see here is that we have the file path to each of the images, and then we have the corresponding label here. So in a sense, this CSV file is a mapping from file path to label. So let's do the same thing for the test set. So this is essentially the same code, except that we are running this now for the test set. And yeah, we can see it works the similar way. And notice that this data set is not shuffled, it's all ordered. So you have first all the instances corresponding to label 0, then the instances corresponding to label 1, and so forth. We can actually check that. So this should be then all 9s, because 9 is the largest class table. We will actually take care of the shuffling via our data loader. But before we get to that part, we actually still want to divide our data set into a training and a validation data set. So we are going to split the training set into a training partition and a validation partition, where we use the validation partition for tuning the model and the test set that we already have here for the final model evaluation. So we could technically use scikit-learn for the splitting as we've done earlier, but we can also just use pandas, which we are going to use here. So what we are doing here is we are shuffling the training set. So this is essentially a pandas way of shuffling a data frame where we sample from a data frame with a random state. So we are shuffling and we say fraction 1, it means all the data points. If I say 0.5, it will take 50% of the data. Here we are taking 100% of the data. So this is just one maybe a little awkward way of shuffling the data set. Then we are saving the location where we have 90% of the data. So I can maybe execute this separately to show you. So this will be the location where we have 90% of the data. So if we consider the first 54,000 data points, that's 90% of the data. And then the remaining data points would be then for validation. That would be the size minus 54,000, which is 6,000. So we have 6,000 data points for validation and 54,000 data points for training. So here we are selecting these 54,000, and here we are selecting the remaining 6,000, and save those as new CSV files here. Then just to make sure everything looks like as expected, let's actually take a look at tf new train, just to see if it's correctly shuffled. And as we can see, yes, it looks like it's now shuffled. We can maybe print out a bit more here. And we can see, it's nicely shuffled now. Just to make sure, let's do the same thing for the validation set. now we can see, yeah, this is also nicely shuffled. Note that actually the training set does not have to be shuffled within itself because we are going to shuffle via the data loader. However, the shuffling here is important so that when we split the data set into a validation and a sub-training data set, that these validation data points are representative of the whole data set. If we don't do the shuffling, the validation set may only contain images from, let's say, class label 8 and class label 9. So just to make sure the validation set is also nicely shuffled, or contains at least unique instances, let's also call this function. And as we can see, we also have unique or various labels in the validation set. In this video, we downloaded the dataset, pretending this PNG dataset, the MList dataset, is a new dataset for which we want to implement a data loader. So in the next video, let's actually get to it and implement the dataset class and the data loader that we will be using for this dataset.